University, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to tonight's presentation. And I'd like to begin by gratefully acknowledging Aeroscraft International and its parent company, General Shale Brick, for sponsoring this lecture. Dedicated to stone, brick, and limestone innovation and production, Aeroscraft provides exceptional masonry products throughout North America. Tonight, we have the pleasure of welcoming two European architects, Tania Conco and Emmanuel Combarel. Ms. Conco's firm is based in Amsterdam, while Mr. Combarel is based in Paris. Born in Paris, however, Tania Conco spent her childhood in the Congo before returning to France to undertake degrees in architecture and urban planning. After working with architects as diverse as Bernard Huet and Jean Nouvel, she founded her own architectural and planning office in 1997. In collaboration with Pierre Gauthier, her project for the 10-acre Zandwerf district of Zaandam in the Netherlands won several awards, including the Prix du Moniteur in 1999, which recognizes the work of emerging architects. Along with Rem Koolhaas, she was part of the quality team for the new city center of Aalmeer in the Netherlands from 1998 to 2008. Ms. Conco's design approach is based on what she describes as, quote, a critical understanding of urban reality. Teaching and practicing in both the Netherlands and in France, her work questions architecture through an urban, social, and programmatic context. Emmanuel Combarel, who along with his partner Dominique Marc, founded ICDM, or ECDM Architects, in 1996 after receiving a number of awards. And for the past 18 years, Monsieur Combarel has focused on designing what he describes as living environments through the practice of architecture and informed by the mutations and transformations of society. The firm's work pits individual sites and programs against larger issues such as the quality of the environment, landscape, and the mixing of uses and ways of life. Mr. Combarel's work has been described as, quote, a simple, sober architecture following a rigorous logic with no preconceptions, nostalgia, or stylistic preoccupations. Ms. Conco and Monsieur Combarel have been here in Ottawa since last Thursday, attending sessions at City Hall and visiting sites in Ottawa as diverse as Le Breton Flats and Barrhaven. They are here along with several others from France as part of an exchange with the city of Lyon. The visitors have been invited to comment on patterns of growth in Ottawa, both on the periphery and in the core, based on their experiences in working in France. In addition to our key sponsor for tonight's lecture, namely Aeroscraft, I'd like to also to acknowledge the support provided by the Embassy of France, in particular Julie Gallo and Thomas Michelon, and by the City of Ottawa, and in particular Councillor Jan Harder and Alain Miguelez, who heads the city's initiatives on zoning and intensification. Tonight's presentation will begin with a presentation by Monsieur Combarel on the work of his firm and then Lyon Confluence, and then we'll switch gears and switch over to a presentation by Madame Conco. So without further ado, thank you for your patience, and it's my pleasure to introduce Emmanuel Combarel.
Okay, good evening. I'm going to talk about Lyon Confluence mostly. So just a short presentation of our studio. We are based in Paris. We work on the architecture. This is Dominique Marek. She is the DM, I am the EC. This is our studio. Okay, so it's a Lyon Confluence. You can see the small orange square here. It's, you know, if you go straight to east, you will find Lyon Confluence. It's exactly the same latitude than Ottawa. So Lyon, they think they are the center of Europe. No, Lyon is here. And you can see all the industrial part of Europe here and there. And between, you have Lyon. So this is what we call the Grand Lyon. So it's all this era. And you can see the Rhône here. It's a large river. And the Saône here. And Lyon is at the confluence of these two rivers. So here you have the Massif Central. It's a very old mountain. and on the Alps area. Okay, this is the old part of Lyon, and we're going to talk about this era that we call Lyon Confluence. It's a new town that we start to work on it about 10 years ago. So, geography is very important in Lyon because here you have a mountain, you have the sun, and this is what we call the couloir rhodanien. That means it's the only place to go from the north to the south when you go through France. So each year, you know, all the Europe that go to the south to go to the Riviera go through through Lyon by this big highway that go here across the city. So this is the part of Lyon Confluence. You can see it's all that area. It's about 150 hectares. And it's as important as old Lyon. Old Lyon, this part, it's a very beautiful city. It used to be a Roman city. So you have the Cardo Decumanus, a very orthogonal plan, like you know in North America, but it's very rare in France. It makes it very simple, very clear urbanism. It's quite dense, not very high. And this city is cut in two parts with a big infrastructure. Okay, this is this infrastructure. Here you have the station. It's one of the first station in France. The first train was made in France go from Saint-Étienne to Lyon. So it's from the early 19th century. And this is a big exchange for an highway that was made in the late 60s. And these two infrastructures, this was considered like a very modern infrastructure. A lot of people came from all over the world to see it. But now it cuts strongly the city in two parts. And now we have to deal with that. It's very complex. Now, I was with a French ambassador yesterday, and he lives close to this place. And he told me that in 18 years, he went only twice through this infrastructure. So it's very complex to go through. And one defined it now to make it simple to go through. So a picture of it. But this is very clear traffic now. During summer, when all the German, Dutch came to the Riviera, you can have 30 kilometers of traffic jam. 10 years ago, there are new highways that go around Lyon, but it's still a very big traffic. Okay, so this is the station. And this was the industrial part of the city. And you can see some beautiful buildings, especially this one. This one is the jail. It's a very interesting jail. It was made by Baltar. Baltar was a great French architect from the 90s. And it's very characteristic. He invents what we call this type of plan with like a star. So now I am in the south of Confluence. This is the big infrastructure, and this is the all industrial part of the city. Okay, this is from the early 17. The Confluence was here, and it was a kind of muddy part of the so not urban at all. And this is one century later, but you can see it was already cut in two parts very strongly. Okay, a little bit of history. So in this territory, you have the abattoir, I don't know in English, a gas industry, and the first station. This is a harbor that was closed 20 years ago. It moved a little bit in the south, and this is was a big market that it now moved away from this area. So this is the harbor, the jail. The jail now going to be a Catholic university. So it's a nice revenge. But it's been classified. It's what we call panoptic plan, you know, with a very easy way to survive, so to control the building. Okay. This is Lyon Confluence when I first start to work on it. I did not do the master plan. I was working as an architect. Another view. Okay, so three parts. First part is this one. It's where all start. This is a in between era with some old building, and we're gonna work with a specific era. And this is a new part that's gonna start in a few months. Okay, that's at the end. So. You have some information. Look, it's about 40 hectares, 40,000 square meters. Okay, and this is how they make the plan. No, so you have the confluence here. First, it's how to use the key, no, to make this a place to. That you can work, you know, in the 19th century and in the 20th century, the city was very intrusive and did not use at all the river. So now it's a very nice place, and the first thing what to do with the river. So it makes a big park. And the other thing to bring the forest that you have here inside here, no, to change the industrial, very mineral era into the park, garden, and green. Continue to go through this big infrastructure. Donc, the bank here. Okay. So, Sainte-Blandine, it's bigger because you have a lot of old buildings. Some are and some new one will be built. It starts now, and this is a new park. It's Herzog de Meuron that does the master plan. Herzog de Meuron is some Swiss architect, very famous. So, it's the first phase. So you can see the change, some building appears on the bank. Here you have a commercial center. This is mostly office and housing. And this is what we call Saint-Blandin that we set in second time. Okay, so here you have a picture of what has been done this past 10 years. So it's the first part that all this building, and in the south, along the river too, and this is the second part. Okay. The soil was very contaminated, so they dig it, and they make a big. Piece of river, I don't know the name in English. So it's you can okay. This so it goes through the island on about 400 meters. It's quite large. By night, this is the monolith. So, donc against the railway. A big building. C'est-à-dire qu'on co-building. This is a conseil général made by Christian de Pozampar. It's not his best building, but it's nice. Okay, Jacob et Mafalan building, it's an office building, iconic building of this era, public space. And at the end here, with all this new era, they make a very important museum by Copy Memblo. This is the Museum of Confluence that will be finished in 2 years, hopefully, with a 3 or 5 years late, delayed. Okay, it was a concerto program. Concerto is a European program of research program about sustainability. So it was quite efficient in terms of energy. Sometimes it's snowing in Lyon. So there was a big thinking about how to move to. So it's like a tramway. Lyon was the first city that used public bicycle. It was 15 years ago. Okay, the second part that you see. One critique that was made on the first part, it was a collection of architecture. And the second part will be more white with more unities between the building. So something maybe a little bit more stray. Okay, this is a building on which I work. It was at this place. Here, it was the where they did the big swimming pool. Let's call it that way. Okay, and this you can see the railways here, the ground. So it's here. Okay, and we have the red one here. It was the first competition on Lyon Confluence, and. We work with 2 developers, and we was 5 architects. And we wanted to work on the mixed cities. So this is the master plan that Greter made. Greter was the urbanist that did the study on this place. So this is what happened with the competition, you know, with all the proposal. Okay, and we work on this building, and we decide to make it very simple. This is a picture of Rue de Rivoli. I like a lot this street. It's a very nice street, and you have the same building for 2 kilometers, and nobody noticed that. But it's very strong and very urban. You can see. It's a little bit different, but this is on the edge of the Saône at Lyon, and this is a detail. This is for me urbanism. No, it's very sophisticated. You have different buildings that were made at different time, but they share the same wall, and together, they fit very well. It's very sophisticated, very impressive. And we try to rethink what could be a city that are able to make something very compact like this. Now, when we make a new city, new building, each building is an object. And we wanted to make a very compact building with some compact architecture. So this is one of the first sketch. We take a big block and we start to sculpt it with different try, and how 5 architects could deal with one volume, how to share this volume. So this is all the studies that we did during the competition. Okay, and at the end, we choose this volume, and we divide it in five pieces. So each architect has to do one piece. So this is the five piece. This is the five piece together. It's a very complex building. You have in purple the office building. It's against the railways. It protects from the area from the noise of the train. And you have a commercial building at the bottom, social building. This is for young worker. This is for handicapped people, young worker. This is what we call logement libre, it's accession, social housing. And each building was made together. It was a very tough work, especially for the developer. One section with a big place in the center, so different section. And we work on the same module. We were very disciplined, and we have all the same grill, and we work all on the same grill. So, but you can see the different building, one here, another one, the five. And each one have a piece of office and a piece of residential building. And what we deal together, it's each one have one material and one design of bay and one color. And we have the same material, the same windows and the same color for office building and residential building. So this is facade. And this is what it make. So it's very compact, very urban. We enlarge the street because we're so compact that we can give 8 meters to the street, so it's much more comfortable. This is our part, with very simple facade. The same for office and dwelling. And this is all the different programs that we add inside the building. Donc, office building, dwelling, and dwelling for handicapped people, store at the bottom, social housing. So it makes like this. But it was very complex because each one functions in a specific way. No, the rules are different. The fire rule is different for each part. It was very complex to make. And we did not want to show the difference on the facade. So the same envelope for everything. This is a concrete, a photo of the concrete that makes the building. The inside. Huh? Okay, quickly, I will just in 5 minutes show you what we do in the studio. It was a very specific project, and it's a project made by a group. So we had to adapt us to a group. It was very interesting, and now it's what we do specifically at the studio. This is the first project that we did. It's a social housing for students. It's a neighborhood of Paris. It's concrete, gold concrete. This is inside on the garden. A room, a flat. And it's a perfect grill, and you cannot see wall or you have a perfect square on the facade. Another social housing for students that we did in Epinay. So it's a fourth Chanel. In fact, there a part of the residence in this part, it's for a woman in distress. So we gave them a fourth Chanel. The inside. Okay, Louis Blanc, it's a social housing too. We don't do only social housing, but I don't. It was the first sustainable social housing in Paris. And it took a very long time to make it because we, at this time, you have to make some parking lot on the ground. Under the ground, and nobody have cars in social housing, so we thought it's stupid to make a parking, and we prefer put money in the building, and we propose to make a garden, a place for the kid where you can park your car. In fact, there are only two cars for 70 places, I guess. And it's used as a garden. So this is a parking in the street. And this is a north facade. And we have some, a piece of glass that keeps the outside light, but during the night, it's reverse it. So it makes a Chinese ball. So inside. Okay, this is social housing too, in Paris. Okay, we work a lot about how to enlarge the housing in France. Flats are very small. The average area is 65 meters square. So we work on a lot on extension. So this was the first try. You have two meters eight of cantilever, and then. It's in the same city, in Grenoble, we work on some tower with very large balconies. So it was the first sketch. And now this is construction with big balcony. You have here, you have 4 meters and a half cantilever. And when you buy 60 square meters flat, you have around 40 meters more outside. So, office building in Paris. So here the peripheric, it's a big highway that go around Paris, and we work here on the white era. So we work together with three architects, with Jacques Ferrier and Saarbrücken Newton, these are German architects. And it's how we deal together. We add this part, and this is was the grill on which we work. So it's a straight line. It's just optic deformation, and we make it as a wallpaper. And this is a plan. No, each plan is different, and you can see. Okay. So this is an angle. This is an office building for RATP. RATP is public transport of Paris, and we have a big parking lot, and we can deform the concrete piece. and make this. And it's go under on the ground. Okay, this is for EDF, Centre de Recherche. This is a very famous classic place. It's called Place des Vosges, and it's the office building was about the same side, so it was 100 meters on the 100 meters around. And it was a very interesting subject. It's how to make researchers work together. No, they are very independent, and how the building can help to make exchange of information inside. So very interesting work on the cellular building. So this is how he work inside a patio. So this is a patio that you can see here. And we lost the competition, but they lack the project. So we make another competition that we win. It's this one, just it was the research center is here, and we do this project that we're working on. It's a campus. It's for formation for EDF too. So this is the patio inside. So it's a multi-building with a different program at different level. Okay, so this is a small nursery that we just finished. It's a little Eden for our child in Paris. This is a burn wood that we have on the top. This is concrete. It's a very performant concrete that we call ductal. The inside, the court. Okay, so it's a complex courbe and a contre-courbe. Dwelling in Paris, in the suburb of Paris for Montreuil, Bordeaux, Toulouse, Nanterre, Montpellier. We work around France, Rennes, Mulhouse. We start the construction of this. It's a little bit like we did in Grenoble. But we develop. What we want to do is to make a villa, superposed villa, more than a flat. So you have a very large balcony. You have a very small garden at the edge, and you have big cellar that make the competition. Okay, this is a future competition. I'm working on it. We deliver the competition at the end of the week. So it's a sub of France, another in Cergy. Okay, thank you.
Voilà Tania Kanko.
Okay, so oops, this is a bit of adaptation. Okay, thanks very much to receiving us here. So it's been a very nice 2 days so far. So 3 days, sorry, already three actually. And I was glad also to see all the presentation of all these strong and very good projects from Emmanuel Combarel that actually few I didn't know. And one is actually in one of the projects I will like to talk about. In fact, I just wanted to perhaps just take the opportunity to, in a way, the fact that we had to think and to see already a few of your sites here, which are actually on the way to renewal. I was thinking that in a way, what could be interesting is, of course, I will talk about my own vision and our own interpretation about the site of Lyon Confluence. But it's actually just to think about, just more globally, perhaps about those stories of those industrial sites. So I will do like all the Dutch coming, going to Lyon via Amsterdam that Emmanuel was mentioning, and I will drive then directly from Amsterdam where is your office. So actually our office take place in a site which that was a site of course a few decades ago that now has been renewed. It's part of those very industrial sites in the harbor of Amsterdam, right in the center of the city. And at a certain moment, those sites were actually totally obsolete, and they decide to remove them into new neighborhoods. So they called now the islands, and on those islands you have in a very in a structure which actually is very close, still very close from the industrial warehouse. You have now taking place housing, all kind of forms of housing, collective, compact, individual, as well businesses, offices, equipments, of course, facilities, shops, etc., retail, etc. So that shows a little bit of what is done with. You can see that one of the most important, I think, of those sites, and of course Holland is a bit different, quite different from Canada in that sense, is that the land is actually quite rare. But nevertheless, it's actually an attitude that you will find all the way in Europe now, is that even if you have some land, some countries still got some, Spain or even in France, we have quite some land. The attitude is really to save it and to try to build as compact as possible, as dense as possible. But density doesn't mean always that you have to build very high. You can build actually quite low, as long as actually you are compacting things and find other way actually to think about individual housing. So actually the office went actually based in Amsterdam after having winning a competition for renewal of industrial site, which is located in one of the oldest of Europe, one of the oldest industrial area of Europe, and that's called Zandwerf. It's located in Zandstad. And just one thing, I won't stay very long on it, but that's the first feeling actually that we had when we discovered the site. It was somewhere to still find that those sites was getting quite of a strong poetry. There was kind of something very poetic coming out of it, and we knew that we had to demolish those buildings, which were because the site was a very, very highly polluted site, and we couldn't keep any of those. But somewhere the question was, how can we restitute actually neighborhood housing without losing this quality, those huge mass carrying on the water, this relationship very strong. So, not sure if the quality is very good, actually. Sorry about that. So the proposal was actually to keep a sort of skyline of those mass, and to even though of course it was housing and it was no longer factories, but to work out with a skyline and with a mass, and not to change totally, not to totally lose the identity of the site, because it is a question, of course, of identity. And we wanted to keep also a certain way to restitute this floating idea, so we proposed, that was also something for the pollution soil, it was to just get rid of all the pollutant. There was some point of pollution until 30 meters in the ground. It was impossible to take out until 30 meters of ground. So what we proposed was to actually have some parking which are half in the water, half water, I don't know how to say it in English. And with this, we could restitute the open-air parking, and with that, in a way, we were just placing all the ground floor housing on a base of which was upon the polluted ground. So actually, it was a trick, but it was a trick which somewhere was giving also a very special identity to those blocks. And well, they are just my mascot in French. they were old couple. This man was actually he was working in one of those factories, and he decided to get an apartment exactly where he was working. And he had one of the most nicest compliments that I had on this work. He said, "Look, in Dutch, of course, but I won't tell you in Dutch." So this is actually, it's modern, but it belongs to the Zaan. The Zaan being the river, which actually was this industrial river. So coming down slowly to Lyon, of course, I passed by Paris, and very quickly, it's true that this work over this industrial sites give us a certain, let's say, certain approach, a certain interest for those sites. And we had a chance to work on the studies in the north of Paris, sort of 200 hectare sites, which is sort of, it's very specific land because it's really in between the, I try to work with that. I'm never very good. Yeah. So it's specific land. It's in between the big roads and sort of highway coming into Paris. This is Paris. This is here the périphérique. It's a sort of, you can think it's a sort of highway, big highway during all the belt of Paris and running around. And here, a second part of quite high driving traffic places. And there, really, one of the main railway going, in fact, to the north and going in time to the Gare du Nord. So a sort of territory quite specific, really hang and tight in between railway, in between highway, in between, and forming at the end a very specific quality, I would say, of blocks, which were no longer blocks, no longer hillocks, but more like really islands. And we actually explore what would be to convert this area into a sort of archipel, you say this? So one of those sites, and just very quickly, is one of those really close by Chapelle Internationale, close by the railway. And the idea was to think, so it's let, I like this idea to say that, okay, within this 200 hectare site, actually it was few, there was few pointed that could be seen really like a sort of acupuncture in a way. It's like you have a large territory and then on one point you look, okay, what could be do, and you dive a little bit into what it would be. We have this chance over a competition that we lost to rethink and dig a little bit more in our stories, and we propose, the images are not good. Problem, technical problems. But the idea was really to work out with different type of density, different type of blocks, work out what we call sort of thick lot, on which you could actually go back to another type of housing, offering actually the quality of living in individual housing in a way, having large outside space, having some lot of green, and in the same time being compact and collective. Equipments, school, cultural center, some offices, but mixed use. So all mixed use neighborhoods, taking it as a real key. Knowing that at the end, I think what is not to forget actually is all the work we can do over those neighborhoods is the best, is or the best, or the target, the objective is of course to bring back some attractive neighborhood, but also neighborhood in which people can live together in a mixed city, but as well also just have some pleasure in neighborhood. Go back to the pleasure of living in space is something that is for us quite important. And then finally, I arrive to Lyon Confluence. So I will go quickly, because first, the quality is not good, and second, Emmanuel did a very strong and complete talk about it. This master plan from François Gréter, and then divide into three what they call ZAC, which are those phases, a sort of way to phase actually the work, and to start with the phase one. So, as in all those developments, of course, the main key is first to have some very good distribution, very good transportation, that transport, collective transport are good and well established, and that the connection is actually around the site, of course, but also crossing the site. And that's a way to really get a sort of irrigation of the site. And this goes through different, what we call, I don't know if it's the case in English, it says soft transport. So it's a tramway, it's bicycle, electric cars, and this is taking place, of course, in the neighborhood, which is, it's also the case more and more, well, not more and more, always now in France, that those neighborhoods are highly sustainable. They are really targeting the sometimes zero consumption environmental consumption, or at least in this one it was 50% and 40% new energy. 70% new energy. So that's, of course, require all kind of equipment like photovoltaic and so the global project. Here is actually the lot where we've been working on. So you had the one that Emmanuel Combarel was working on, and we are just here, directly in contact with the Parc de Saône, which have been done by landscapers. It's called Michel Levine. I'm really sorry because the image are such bad quality, but and I just want perhaps just to make a bracket. It's in the way the work is done, or the process of work is done in France. So you have urbanist making a master plan, and Then after, within master plan, there is a definition of certain lots, or so sometimes they are ilots, sometimes they are called low, sometimes, anyway. And from then, some competition are organized. In this case, it was together architect and developers on same lot, and then there is a winner. The interesting thing is that, and that's also happened more and more in those organisms, is that the municipality stays quite involved in the development, and in a way, it's quite good because they can really get a sort of, they become a sort of warrant in a way of a certain quality. There is a certain balance in between the developer, the private developer or public developer, the architects, and the what we call the SEM, which are, I don't know how to translate it actually, which are the sort of groupment of municipality, the municipality, and they are the people who are developing actually the land. So that's to talk about process. So in our case, we when we start to work on this this ELOT, in fact, what we've been really extremely stunned by was really just the landscape, because in this area, in a way, it doesn't matter the master plan, I would say, the landscape and the place, the configuration, the geography is so strong in between the two rivers, the La Saône and the Rhône, and it's really give a sort of very specific configuration to the or atmosphere, I would say, to the place. So in a way, we wanted to build, of course, but we just wanted to try to find a way to put, to really place this geography on the real heart of our work, and on the real heart of the way we will look for the housing, and we'll do the housing there. Whatever was about the water, the transparency, the way that we could actually go starting from a block and then end up to something which could be kind of something more really directly in contact with the water, with the landscape, and with this notion of stones idea. So we then end up with those this configuration of those four blocks. Here as well, you can see that it's quite dense. Actually, that was a constraint or something given really by the urbanist. And it was quite scary at the beginning, because we're thinking, okay, maybe actually it could be that the apartments are sort of suddenly quite close to each other, and that. But the fact that we work out all the apartments with double, sometimes triple orientation, the fact that somewhere we were in such a contact with this great landscape, this very large landscape, was actually making that at the end it doesn't look so stuck together, so much together. It's actually quite nice to have this story of contrast. I think it's something which, whenever we are in countries which have a lot of land, or in countries which have a bit less land, the research of contrast is still something positive that is allow actually two different emotion, I was going to say. And you can see there are this landscape is actually present everywhere, wherever, reflecting in all the glass walls, in the apartments themselves. They really, the landscape invites itself in apartments, and the dialogue is always there. And I think this is also something when landscape is so beautiful and so amazing, you just want to really talk with it as much as possible with the building. So it's that's at least was our attitude. You can see there are the also the photovoltaic have been also treated in a way that they really belong to the building. They're not really as something which is put on top. More and more, we're going to have to build with those elements, and that's something that we have to integrate in a statical way that should really belong to the buildings that we are creating. And we also use this constraint in a way of having to answer to very, very high environmental issues, to propose to build housing in, we call that with a double skin. So you have the main isolated skin there, and then around you have a sort of glass, a little bit like a sort of a dress around the body, which would be float a little bit. And these dresses, all in glass, and allow actually, of course, to have all these very nice spaces that you can just hang around. And I think that's also part of issues that we should target in housing is how to think about what we can offer as plus. Which plus is to think plus. And I think too many times, actually, we are just struggling with our thing, our constraint, our everything which are there, of course, and we just forget actually the main objective, which is really to bring the people within quality spaces. So when you turn around, actually, all along the river, you find actually all this biodiversity, all these differently. So they need to actually live and get urbanized a little bit differently as well. And then I will just go a bit further in Bordeaux. That would be my last to talk a bit more about processes, actually. So this is Bordeaux. This is the city of Bègle. And all in brown is what we call the agglomeration of the city, the metropolitan Bordeaux metropole. So it's a work which was done for the city of Bègle in red, and the city is quite particular. It's not very big. It's more like I would say a closed suburb city. It's about 250-260 inhabitants. And then there is, at the moment, some very large development which are just starting around the whole agglomeration, a lot of challenges. There is the metropole is actually targeting to become 1 million inhabitants. And suddenly, this little town, which was kind of a border of Bordeaux Center, start to think that, okay, in a way, perhaps we could be something within the scope of 20 years. Perhaps we could be something else than just a suburb city. And in a way, when you look about all this connection, again, you have a place which is extremely well connected wherever with the roads, with the infrastructure, with also four very strong presence of green, a river, and as well also a very strong connection which is done, and that's also important, is the connection actually which are done in between the different cities which are all around in the agglomeration. So the place actually in itself was get actually all the potential to really becoming something else than just a suburb. So we are in charge actually still, because it's a project, it's a competition that we won in 2006 and should be finished in 2014, within 2 years. And the site which was given is this site, which is right along the big boulevard, which is the belt in between Bordeaux and between all the little communes around. So what we want, what we propose was actually to redo a sort of center for the city, taking actually hanging on the flux and hanging on the different spaces, hanging as well on the fact that somewhere we could buy a public space, and that's where I want to go with you on this project, is how the public space can get a strong role into connection and into create different type actually of first different image for the city, and as well kind of go for a real conviviality and real change of use and play a role within the society, on the scale of the neighborhood, but as well on the scale, because on this site we are directly linked with the metropole, as well on the site, on the metropolitan site. So this is the site like it was when we got it. So here it's an ancient military site, and there that was a residential area from the 60s. With what we know, bars, towers, and the tramway is actually, the tramway line is decided to link the station and to go through and actually link the south of the south of the site, and to give another actually reading to the place. So that was the starting point, is that the municipality of Bègles managed to have the prolongation of a very good tramway line, which is going directly to the station. The station will be connected with the TGV linking. TGV, sorry, is the speed train linking Paris and Bordeaux in 2 hours. So suddenly this site, which was at the middle a little bit of, not the middle of nowhere, but actually left over, became suddenly a site which is at 2 hours and a half from the heart of Paris. So, of course, that's bring new perspective. So what we propose is to first create a proper square on the scale of the metropolitan scale, square a little bit specific, because in a way the public space is directly connected with the building. So three entity, which in a way will have all a kind of quite specific public space, because we didn't want to have, a traditional public space going along the tramway and things. We thought in a way that what could be more interesting is to work it out more by sequence. So here the perspective are not centralized, but they are offering perspective, they are offering sequences, and by sequences they offer specific places as well. Another point was that we had to demolish the towers which was there in order to make the tramway line going through, and the tramway is a real chance for the neighborhood, because that's also what's linking and what's suing, I would say, the neighborhood to the rest. But what we wanted as well was not to break down everything, and we kept two of those bars that are actually Restructurate, I don't really like the term. They are really renewed. They are changed in the shape. We add some programs. I will go further. We are really start a metamorphose of them. Of course, this is a master plan, and in this master plan, there is different architects working in it. So just to give you a little glimpse of what it was, this was the plaza. So you can see sometimes some spaces and the emptiness can be quite poor in certain area, and the challenge is then quite even more important. Some of those buildings which are going to be refurbished. Yeah. And how we actually want to imagine it, bringing plaza, bringing spaces, bringing new programs there, bringing new shape, changing as well the shape of the building, bringing as well using the fact that the site is located near a neighborhood which have actually at the moment kind of quite of a booming over a large program of media and over all the art of image. I don't know how to say it in English. All the work touching image, movies, etc. We thought that this interaction could be interesting when, for example, they use as well the building for whatever event items. So, just to go a little bit, I wanted just to show you just very quickly. I will go quite quick. How the work is actually delivered. It was more to talk about a process. Having done this master plan, having won this competition, then we work out, these are just a few of those maps, of course, that we have, where you just define actually the different types of road. You define as well the type, in a way, and the way you're going to define the size of road, the size of... We'll define, of course, the atmosphere that you will have in the place. So clearly what we wanted was to avoid to have the big traffic. We kept the tramway line really sliding over the square, so being part totally of the square, and then becoming here, going along a more kind of quite commercial area. But what we wanted was to preserve on each scale some sort of, some collective space, which could be also, which are and should be a link as well with a neighborhood, existing neighborhoods, or now it's kind of this future or center that I was talking about with the media. The space of the green is also a choice. This is essentially a quite large mineral place, because again, in certain cases, and that was the case of Bègles, Bègles needed a city center. Bègles didn't need to have a square with green grass, etc. Bègles needed to have a certain urbanity, a certain density that the city was lacking. So I just mentioned that because sometimes, I think the position have to be quite relevant regarding with what is existing around, and not just come with whatever. Even if they are, of course, positioned rather difficult to stand, because of course, in any neighborhood, the inhabitant, and especially in this neighborhood, they want to have green. So we propose some green, but not somewhere in the square, on the big square, which have this metropolitan scale, but more inside of an existing building, And what we propose, and that's in a way on the social aspect, is a way as well to, we call it, in Holland they call that this social control. I think that you have something perhaps equivalent here. But it's mean that as long as you give some programs in the ground, as long as you make that spaces become collective, of course, it's like a square with green and things, it's closed in the night and it's open in the morning, you offer actually a possibility that those places which were totally closed, which where you had all kind of deal going on, drugs deal, etc., suddenly become something totally different. And we like to work very much with places, with atmosphere that we can get, with thinking of all the possible crossing, not offering only one way to circulate. And of course, as a main tool is the programs, is ground floors with different type of programs, shops, of course, but not only, as well some local associative rooms or some places which are given for arts craft or bigger activity, shops, supermarket. Here we were expecting to have a strong public building. Well, I can give you a scoop, is that we don't know for the program, but for the architect, it will be Emmanuel Combarel. So, and this is tied with different architects I will show you after. So this is what we're working, let's say, from a master plan, which is, of course, theoretical, and are we actually moving it progressively to a neighborhood, to something which will be alive, to something which connects, in which there is interaction, wherever it's into program, into places, into different intensities, that's things that's happening on the different places with different atmospheres. I'll go a bit quicker. So this is the architects of the two of those blocks, working with typology that was actually given, that we give in the master plan, which was to work out with, I would say, behind those big facade, work out really with kind of quite of a density and quite of a compact buildings. In between, different type of public space, which is more on scale of a neighborhood, I would say, neighborhood scale, giving as well some possible subtype of those big, large furniture that are also bringing the furniture, the urban furniture is also something very important, because depending what you bring an atmosphere, but you also, how to say in English, you're pushing for a certain type of conviviality, you're pushing for a certain type, and these are extremely important element, of course, which are not left over. The square that I was talking about with the refurbishment. So here again, this is going to be refurbished. This is new. Going slow. The architect, Lanois Courion, which are have been refurbished, and then it's always going with part of extension, part of... These are social housing, so they actually quite very social housing. So the budgets are extremely short and tight, but let's say with different as well shaping and different intervention towards the contemporaneity of the building, it is also a way to associate existing building and their inhabitants, which are still there, which are maintained in the same place, to the whole global renewal. And this tie in between the existing inhabitant and, or the one who are already in place, and the new one which is going to come, and the different social class, and it's extremely important. The same strong attention must be place to the as well to the social, then to the free sector. Here again, some not prescription, but towards urban furniture, which should also move to more contemporary space. The second space is also in between two buildings, the way also to link here together with the neighborhood, which is there in the back, is quite active. So, so offering those connection here is quite important for us. And there again, some prescription about certain capacity, I would say. Oh, the image is terrible. Yeah. Public space, different type of public space, different type of prescription as well towards different green in these places. Also thinking again different way to sit, and then the main square that we are as well designing with a different building, which is a bit of a specific square. We wanted that the building and the plaza become actually just one. That in a way you could have some public space infiltrate the building, lifting up. So I always call the plaza is a little bit like a sort of plissé. I don't know if it's a French term, but and in his folding, it's a bit like a folding one. And within the folding, we find actually the different type of green or different type of fountain, water, and that's create at the end one element and coherence of element, and as well something which in a way is never really given in one goal. It's a public space that you discover progressively. I think public space is also about that. In a way, one of the cities that I love the most is Siena. It's in Italy, and it's this 16th century spaces, in a way, which are not rectangular. They are not, and they are composed and working very tight within the buildings. And that's what we wanted to restitute here. These are buildings that we are doing ourselves, housing, different type, also work in the buildings that things can actually be more in interaction as well with the public space. One of the refurbishments which have been done by architect in Kong, so the facade over the street. The street here where the bus. So this was this terrible bar building that we saw before, which is now totally renewed with activity on the ground, and is also part of this square, actually this moving square, and our buildings there, and the global thing. So just to conclude, I just want to say that I think it's possible to do some neighborhood which are, or to create neighborhoods, or to renew some neighborhood, or to partly renew them
It is possible to do them with a strong social cohesion. It is possible to imagine them as a contemporary neighborhood and not as a 19th century neighborhood. And it's possible to do that with all the quality possible, with all the... And that's actually should be really our aim to all the people working with the city. And one thing that I myself learned quite a lot, in Holland, is the working together. They call that, it's the samenwerken, they call that. And it's just about understanding at a certain point that if we want really to make things going further, if we want to place our cities in a strong, sustainable way, and to place them on the map of the contemporary world, we have to work together. We have to work together, municipalities, of course, or the décideurs, or politics, the developers, private, public, the architects and urbanists. It is one. And this working together is actually the key to, I think, achieve a certain vision. Thanks. Thank you very much.
So, for those of you who'd like to stay for a few minutes, I would like to offer the opportunity for the audience to pose some questions, if there are any, to our speakers. Certainly what we saw, and those who of you who travel in Europe realize that European cities are by no means static. Parts of them are quite old, but there are huge sectors of European cities that are in the process of completely reinventing themselves. And for the European architect, architecture is an urban undertaking. I think what was fantastic tonight was to see how architects in Europe get to think both at the urban scale and at the building scale. Any questions? Okay then. Well then, thank you all very much for coming, and again, thanks very much to our...
On the planning of the
urban scale, if there was a percentage that was supposed to be left in your goal for green space, and
that was
as much as an
important thing as the buildings themselves.
Do you want to come up and speak, Tanya, come here, this way.
Yeah. Of course, there is a certain percentage. There is always, everywhere, a certain percentage of green. In this case particular, we could actually have less green than normally we should, because our site, the north and the approach to the whole metropolitan structure, was actually working with another site below, which is more in articulation with neighborhoods. So in a way, because it was not that large, they combine both, and there is one we have more green and another one a little bit less, in order to achieve the necessary urbanity, because again, it's a place which really lacking from a center, and that's what gives us an urbanity.
Why the mid-rise rather than the movement toward towers?
In which side?
all of the sites that you showed were all
the sites? Oh,
yeah.
Well, it's in the it depends of size. I think there's different things. That first in France, maybe Emmanuel, you want to precise that. There's specific regulation, for example, in Paris for high building. In different cities, it's the same. Unfortunately, France is not really the country where we can build up very high. But on the other hand, as well, in this last project that I show, it was there was some high-rise building, and actually all the neighborhood didn't. It was really very badly perceived. So the target was actually to create density, but without going with high building. And that's a little bit the challenge that we took. And in a way, what I find interesting is that it's allow as well to explore another type of density, which is more linked with compacity, the compact building, and that's also give another exploration and opening where to others types of housing, for example. But well, we would like to do more high. That's for sure.
I have a question for both of you, but unfortunately, you may have difficulty because of language, but. I'll speak at my level anyway. I'm a practicing architect here. Your work is very seductive, but I refer that in my political position, I refer that as the neo medievalism in architecture. And that's because you do work in social housing, you do work with the private sector, government, we call here the P3s. And they're very sort of lords of the castle that work in isolation, that ask all the intellectuals, the architects, the planners, whatever. The whole political process that deals with normally or naturally deals with the development of cities and the way cities grow and the urban patterns that are formed through time, it's all gone now. It's all synthetic. It's all instant. And so architects are being used, architects and planners are being used as instruments by these higher powers to get the accumulations of these territories and just fill it with stuff. And the level of architecture that is done at that stage, that political state, is nothing different than when one designs the interior of a LCBO store, like a liquor control board store, where you have all these beautiful colored bottles arranged in space and stuff like that, nice labels, nice addresses, whatever. So my question is that as architects, we're facing a very critical juncture in our civilization, and that is that we're going towards more of a medieval structure in the world. Agenda 121 of the United Nations is an example of that. I don't know if you're familiar with Agenda 121, but Agenda 121 basically is going to be the ruination of architecture as we knew architects to be in the past. It's not going to be that humanistic thing anymore. It's going to be all formulated by things like intensification and ecological this and that. You know, they've hijacked the ecological movement to do that, intensification, centralization of powers. And so all these examples that you're showing us here is wonderful, beautiful examples of centralized conditions in beautiful urban settings that were naturally formed through centuries and centuries. So a synthetic condition in a natural playground. And I haven't heard you people talk about public input into this planning, even before they got to the architects, like the master plans. How were they generated? You know, because we have this problem here in Canada now. We have this problem in Ottawa. We have this problem in Toronto. There's not enough public input at the ground level of this territorial development before architects get involved and before others get involved. So I think as architects, we have to take on a very political position.
Of course, I agree.
You know? And because that's what architects are. Engineers are not. And planners are not necessarily, because planners work for municipalities. Okay, you gotta go. This is important. It's all about, read Agenda 21. Everybody read Agenda 21. United Nations Agenda 21. That is the death knell of our way of living. And our society, like our Planning Act, has already accepted it, adopted it in all of its clauses. And it's spooky stuff, but thank you very much. It wasn't a question, it was a little lecture, but.
Other questions?
Thank you for this opportunity. I just wanted to congratulate you, it was wonderful to see such a use of renewable energy as 70% and 80% levels, as we could learn about that here in Canada. Congratulations on that. I was just wondering if you had utilized or if it was thought of to use a monorail in your architectural work in your projects at all.
What?
It's a type of transport that runs on a single track, a monorail.
In certain proposal there is some that is true. There is some proposal about the monorail, for example, in Grand Paris, done by Ports en Part, about all those thoughts. So it is indeed part of the global reflection.
Wonderful, glad to hear it, because I have learned they're putting a solar-powered monorail in Bologna, Italy, right now. I did a presentation a year ago on July 14th of last year to the mayor and company at City Hall for a solar-powered monorail here in Ottawa. And I just learned a few days ago, I don't know if you folks have learned this as well, but the train system we have going into Vancouver is equal to the one we're doing here in Ottawa, and it's half the price in Vancouver as the one that's going in here. And I've asked the mayor that. I sent the mayor when he did a presentation.
We want to give others an opportunity. You've got someone right behind you. Thank you very much. Question? No, we're going to try to let the speakers speak, but thank you. Question right behind you?
This is a question more for Emmanuel, if he's still here. The question was about the block, the buildings that you worked on. It was all segregated, it was all separated, and I'm sure there's a reason for it. The social housing was grouped together, the handicap housing was grouped together, the student housing was. Was that done on purpose because of economic or corporate reasons? Why, or did you explore, at least in a North American context, in Canada and the US a lot, you're trying to mix, to have that mixture, but to mix it so that people don't know, you walk in that door, oh, he's in social housing. You walk in another door, you know which building you're going to or which section of the building. So was there a reason why it was broken up in those pods, as opposed to putting social housing throughout, so that you could have that more of a mixte of the different populations?
Yeah, you're right. What happened for social housing, for example, it's a specific public institution that runs the part of the building, so you cannot mix because specific financiary, specific money, etc. So it's very complex. It's not the same way that we give money that in Canada, I guess. So they give money to the public institution, they're going to build a building. And what happened in the 60s in France, it's that we build some, we did that we call zoning, and we make with some place with a lot of social housing, other place with office building, et cetera, et cetera. What we try to do is to mix it and to make, now we have to make in most part of France, in the big city, 25% of flats that is social housing. But it's a special...
It can't be in the same building.
Yeah, it's not. Not possible. And when there was a question about tower, why we were so low, it's just a question of culture. We don't have the culture of tower in France. We do a few, but it's very complex, it's very expensive, and we don't have the right fire rule to make it very efficient. So we don't do high building in France.
Emmanuel and Tania, thank you very much for your presentations. Perhaps a question that is of interest to me and to the two of you. What types of households, in your experience, would locate, would choose a flat in either Lyon-Confluence or in Bègle or in some of the projects that you've illustrated where you're trying to create that urbanity? The flats, how big are they and who are the households? Are they households with children, without children, single couples? What has your experience been?
I'll just give a short translation. Quel type de logement en fait et quel type de population on va expérimenter en fait sur l'ensemble des bâtiments et des projets. So just in roughly for me, in fact for whatever project, each project, as a little bit what Emmanuel was saying, we have now this traditional huge mixity. So it's mixed use at the beginning, and then for housing as well, you can have, or that's something that we try also to push, that you have all kind of different type of offers. So it goes to the flats. Well, this is more, of course, when you can intervene as an urbanist, because this you can actually work it out as well, proportion of flats, proportion of different typology oriented, where housing, what we call in France, we have type of housing which is called intermediary housing. So it's in between the flat and the individual housing, offering the same kind of outside and etc. And for the, it's mixed social, free sector, sometimes students, and as well for the surfaces, wherever surfaces in France are quite constrained. It depends. Actually, whatever you do, social housing or free sector housing, is all very small. So. It doesn't mean what to add. That way.
Good evening, Tania and Emmanuel. Thank you so much for the presentation. It was quite interesting that the presentations have started with, you know, you mentioned that you are here in Ottawa in order to comment on, you know, the Ottawa patterns. And I'm curious to know, because your architecture is really within the context of the communication with nature and communication with the environment around the built structures. So I'm wondering, what are your comments about Ottawa? And in particular, what are your comments about the connections within the nature and the built environment in Ottawa?
Quel commentaire on peut donner en fait sur Ottawa? Ouais, par rapport sur la qualité. Well, I will give mine, then I will leave the easy question in fact, very difficult question that you asked there to Emmanuel. Well, I'm sorry if I hope that there's no misunderstanding. We came here for first, meeting and having a real exchange about tools, about situation, because it's true that when you go for in this question of a renewal site, have the same question. We're not just looking at in the same way, and the size are slightly different. When we have 60 hectare, we're very happy, and you have sometimes 6,000 hectare. But so apart from those very big differences, but the different items, wherever it's about transportation, wherever it's about housing, wherever it's about employment, wherever it's about. All of those we have the same, and they are treated. So it was, the meaning was, and it was very rich, very intense in terms of exchanging and compare. So let's say it would be very pretentious for me to give any kind of comment. It's my first time in Canada. I stay there since 3 days, 4 days. They are just impression. They are just feelings. They are just that's it. That's all I have. But in a way, what I could see is that I think you are actually quite lucky. You have a lot of chance. You have a lot of space. You have a lot of green. We were saying it last time, well maintained. There's a lot of chances, so a lot of good starting point. I haven't seen neither some suburb really, really quite difficult, and like we can have in Europe sometime where you have really, where we have to do so much to really bring it to the. But I would say what, having saying that, all those actually very good potential there and things, I think what I, but it's just again, it's the first approach and it's probably wrong, but I'm feeling a little bit of these, not lack, but I don't really feel the urban, urban condition, I would say. I was talking about public spaces, I was talking about condition where people meet, I was talking about mixity that you create, actually, that's for me, doesn't matter the shape, doesn't matter if you have towers or compact building or whatever, at the end they all come to the ground, and what's happened to the ground, what is done in the ground in terms of program, in terms of thinking as well, which program with the other one, which kind of synergy of program you are creating. It's a little bit like being doing a scenario in a way for a movie. You have to think that you're going to have different actors. You have to think that, and which kind of story do you give? Which kind of how do you make it happen? How do you make that the sequences are going smoothly? How do you make that actually there is life in it? Because at the end, this is. For me, and that's wherever I was talking about Sienne, it was not to bring back the 16th century, but because I like also anyway those kind of space, like when Emmanuel is showing the Rue de Rivoli, there is some spaces, there is some building which are eternally contemporary because they are right. They are right. And I think this, at the end, the main thing, and this is what we try to do or to think or to bring, and that's the most difficult, is to bring back what do you have? You ask for emotion as well in city. You have to go in a place and say, wow, I'm well, or want to be able to sit there because you're feeling well, want to be. And this is for me the meaning of the public space in cities. I'd never even been everywhere yet in Ottawa, but it could be for me improved, perhaps.
No, at first, when I came to Ottawa, city seems so simple, and I like walk, make walk alone in the city. I walked yesterday for almost half of the day, and I did today, and I think it's much more complex than I thought at the beginning. I see some wonderful neighborhood. Today I went to the stadium, and close to the stadium there was some beautiful housing, very nice, very, we were talking about sustainability. It was a great area with a lot of trees, and I think it's a very nice place to live. But now, after all that, I think the more I walk, the less I understand the city. I don't understand the difference between two buildings. You know, you can have some very old building and a brand new one, a poor building and another one very kind of rich together. You know. I don't understand how the function, the structure of the city. It's very complex. You know, I'm amazing by the city. It's very interesting. I have no solution, no answer. I just try to understand.
Take the opportunity again to thank our guests. One more question.
You. Yeah, I didn't notice any roof landscaping. Were they all solar panels, or how did you achieve such high renewable energy percentages? Was it with solar? And what did you do with the roofs?
No, the roof is the best part of the building, no? Should be terraces, should be something for the kid. So what we try to do now is to develop some new program on roof, and hopefully we can start to do that in France. It used to be used by the technique now, everything that was for the building, but not for the people. I think it's the best place of place of the building. We have to work for the people on the roof. And this is sustainable. You know? Sustainable is not, it's much more a question of how you use, how you live together than technical problem. Yeah.
Thank you. Again, thanks to our speakers, Manuel Comborel and Tania Conco, and thank you again to the French Embassy, the City of Ottawa, and thank you all for coming tonight.